بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, we discussed previously some of the issues related to the description of the hellfire and the most important hadith regarding the issue of sincerity on the day of resurrection and the results of insincerity and those first three people who are punished in the hellfire. And we seek refuge in Allah. We seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who protects, the all-merciful, the one who forgives constantly, to protect you and I from the hellfire on that day. So when we discuss the issue of sincerity, we mention some of the action items that we can take, such as donating in secret, such as praying Qiyamul Layl often, and the rewards and bounties and blessings that encompass a person who does these things often, and that these are powerful tools and very efficient tools in order to fight and to rid oneself of insincerity and riya. And we seek refuge in Allah from any insincerity in all that we do. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we will discuss some of the issues related to the actual inhabitants of the hellfire, the people that actually enter the hellfire, and some of the reasons for that. So, the first type of people are those who will abide in the hellfire, remain in the hellfire eternally. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about these people when He says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَهُمْ نَارُ جَهَنَّمَ لَا يُقْضَى عَلَيْهِمْ فَيَمُوتُوا وَلَا يُخَفَّفُ عَنْهُمْ مِنْ عَذَابِهَا كَذَٰلِكَ نَجْزِي كُلَّ كَفُورٍ. But those who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for them will be the fire of hell. No term shall be determined for these people so that they will die, nor shall its penalty be lightened for them. Furthermore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. But those who reject faith, those who reject faith in the Creator and they belie our signs, they shall be companions or dwellers of the hellfire and they shall abide therein. So these people will abide in the hellfire forever. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes their torment when He says, يُرِيدُونَ أَن يَخْرُجُوا مِنَ النَّارِ وَمَا هُمْ بِخَارِجِينَ مِنْهَا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُقِيمٌ. Their wish and their desire is to escape from the hellfire. To escape from the hellfire. But never will they be allowed to get out from the hellfire, and their penalty will be one that endures, one that is continuous. We also know that on that day, death itself will be slaughtered. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, he said, death will be brought forward like a horned ram, and it will be made to stand between paradise and hellfire. And it will be said, O people of Jannah, O people of Jannah, do you know what this is? And so they will look up and they will say, yes, this is death. And then it will be said, O people of the hellfire, do you know what this is? They will say, yes, this is death. And then the command will be issued for death to be slaughtered. And then it will be said, O people of Jannah, it is eternal, there is no death. O people of the hellfire, it is eternal, there is no death. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited and warned them of the day of grief and regret when the case has been decided, while now they are in a state of carelessness and they disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Furthermore, in a different narration of a Tirmidhi, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, he added, if anyone were to die of joy, if any types of people were to ever die of happiness, it would be the people of Jannah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make you and I of the people of paradise. And then he said, and if anyone were to die of grief or despair, it would be the people of the hellfire. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you and I from the torments of the hellfire. We also know that hellfire will be a dwelling place for the kuffar and the mushrikeen. And this is the gist of when we discuss the subject of the hellfire, the gist of the inhabitants and those who deserve the hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discusses these people when He says, سَنُلْقِي فِي قُلُوبِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا الرُّعْبَ بِمَا أَشْرَكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا وَمَأْوَاهُمُ النَّارُ وَبِئْسَ مَثْوَى الظَّالِمِينَ. Their abode is an-nar. Their abode is the hellfire, and evil is indeed the home of those who are wrongdoers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أُولَٰئِكَ مَأْوَاهُمُ النَّارُ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Their abode is the hellfire because of the evil that they did, because of the constant disbelief and the rejection of the signs of the Creator. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَيْسَ فِي جَهَنَّمَ مَثْوًا لِلْكَافِرِينَ. Is there not a home in the hellfire for those who disbelieve? Those who have the signs in front of them, and they reject the signs. They have the signs and the verses all around them, and they reject the signs. What excuse do they have? On that day, that is their abode, and on that day, they will be filled with grief and regret for the arrogance they had in this world, for the ignorance they had in this world, and for their constant disbelief. Another of the types of the inhabitants of the hellfire are those who call other people with them to the hellfire. So we have the example of those who are misguided, and they try to misguide others with them as well. They try to misguide people from the laws of Allah, the laws of the Creator that He mandated and legislated in order to bring them to their false causes and their false laws. And these are the people who call others to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of these examples, and the greatest example perhaps, is Shaytan himself, the master, the main of the shayateen, Iblis. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا إِنَّمَا يَدْعُو حِزْبَهُ لِيَكُونُوا مِنْ أَصْحَابِ السَّعِيرِ. Shaytan only invites, يَدْعُو, he invites his followers, his adherents, those who are evil, so that they will become companions of the hellfire. Another of the types of people who call others to the hellfire, and Allah mentions this example, is Fir'aun himself, the Pharaoh. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَقْدُمُ قَوْمَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَأَوْرَدَهُمُ النَّارُ وَبِئْسَ الْوِرْدُ الْمَوْرُودِ. Fir'aun will go before his people on the Day of Judgment, and he will lead them into the hellfire because he misguided them. He will also lead them into the hellfire. So anyone who is evil and leads others astray, anyone who tries to attack Islam and claim that it is false in order to bring people away from the Creator, these are in fact people calling others to the hellfire. Because there's only the commandments of the Creator in this world that we follow, or the desires, or the path of evil, the path of misguidedness. And this is the path that ignores the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala around us. Now we also have the example of the man who was there at the time, and he was calling people to Islam, and they were calling him to the hellfire, when he said, وَيَا قَوْمِ مَا لِي أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاةِ وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ وَيَا قَوْمِ مَا لِي أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاةِ وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ. He said, O my people, it is strange that I am calling you to salvation while you call me to the hellfire. وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ. You're calling me to do something evil, meaning you're calling me to do that which leads to the hellfire. So this man's people were calling him to kufr and shirk of Fir'aun while he was calling them to tawheed, to the oneness of the Creator, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have many examples of people in general, in our day and age and in the past, people who try to take others to evil, people who try to misguide others, people who try to make others commit sins, to make them stoop to their level. So the question that you and I should ask ourselves is, what do you and I do when evil comes our way? When people try to tempt us to commit evil, do we resist? Do we remember the hellfire? Do you remember the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do you think of when the decision comes, when you have to decide between good and evil? And we'll take a short break inshallah ta'ala, and when we return, we'll continue talking about those who are calling others to the hellfire. Stick around inshallah ta'ala, we'll be right back. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Another of the types of people who call others to the hellfire, and Allah mentions this example, is Fir'aun himself, the Pharaoh. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَقْدُمُ قَوْمَهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَأَوْرَدَهُمُ النَّارُ وَبِئْسَ الْوِرْدُ الْمَوْرُودِ Fir'aun will go before his people on the Day of Judgment, and he will lead them into the hellfire because he misguided them. He will also lead them into the hellfire. So anyone who is evil and leads others astray, anyone who tries to attack Islam and claim that it is false in order to bring people away from the Creator, these are in fact people calling others to the hellfire. Because there's only the commandments of the Creator in this world that we follow, or the desires, or the path of evil, the path of misguidedness. And this is the path that ignores the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala around us. Now we also have the example of the man who was there at the time and he was calling people to Islam and they were calling him to the hellfire when he said, وَيَا قَوْمِ مَا لِي أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاةِ وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ وَيَا قَوْمِ مَا لِي أَدْعُوكُمْ إِلَى النَّجَاةِ وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ He said, O my people, it is strange that I am calling you to salvation while you call me to the hellfire. وَتَدْعُونَنِي إِلَى النَّارِ You're calling me to do something evil, meaning you're calling me to do that which leads to the hellfire. So this man's people were calling him to kufr and shirk of Fir'aun while he was calling them to tawheed, to the oneness of the Creator, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have many examples of people in general, in our day and age and in the past, people who try to take others to evil. People who try to misguide others, people who try to make others commit sins, to make them stoop to their level. So the question that you and I should ask ourselves is, what do you and I do when evil comes our way? When people try to tempt us to commit evil, do we resist? Do we remember the hellfire? Do you remember the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What do you think of when the decision comes, when you have to decide between good and evil? Always remember the hereafter, always remember the punishment. Always remember that every action or inaction will affect where you end up. Every action will affect where you end up on that day. So make sure when the decision comes, when it's time to act, you choose that which is righteous. Don't let your split second nafs pull you away to that which is evil. Your split second desire pull you to that which is forbidden for you. And so we have the example of those who call other people to the hellfire, such as Iblis himself and Fir'aun, and this woman who tried to seduce this man to evil. Now, a few years ago, there was a university student, and he was a very young man, but he was very righteous, and he was known to be very religious. And so because he was practicing, and because he would not mix in with the different genders and mix in with those people who were having parties and doing impermissible things, he was righteous and he stayed away from that which is immoral. And so some of those evil students, those people with dark hearts, they were included in this example we give of those people who call others to evil. Why? They try to take this boy down. They try to take this young college student away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what did they do? During one of the nights, it was reported in the media that six college students, six girls, females, they came to this man in his dormitory, in his room. And they broke into the room. They knocked on the door and they rushed into the room. They barged in and they tried to seduce this young college student. Six girls at once tried to seduce this man. And they blocked the entrance to his door and they would not allow him to escape. Now, most people, when they heard the story, some of the youth, when I said this story in the past, they would say things like, what is the big deal? He's being forced anyway. What is the big deal? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't judge him. But the reality is, if you are sincere in staying away from sin, you are sincere and you do not want to go anywhere near the hellfire or the traps of the people of the hellfire or the deeds that lead people to the hellfire, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow your sincerity to shine. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow your sincerity to be shown through your efforts. So what did this college student do? This was all over the media. The student actually jumped out the window and he broke his leg. He jumped out the window to avoid the temptation. To avoid the temptation because he knew that if he had stayed any longer, he might have succumbed to the temptation. And so because of his sincerity, he jumped out the window. And those people had gotten in trouble. So when you think about it, nowadays, with so much fornication and adultery being common, and that is a sign of the Day of Judgment, when fornication and adultery is so common, and not just common, but it is acceptable in many societies, it is a huge immorality. It is a huge type of sin. And yet people take it very lightly. They become desensitized to it. They see it over and over and over, including in the media, in movies and television shows. And there are so many evils that people see that they become desensitized to. So over time, When you become desensitized, you think it's normal. And then over time, you think it's so normal that you don't feel it's dangerous for you to do it as well. So this type of path of shaitan is a step-by-step. Khutuwat al-shaytan. He leads people step by step, path after path, until he takes them from stage A, from where they first started, all the way to the sin. And we seek refuge in Allah from the traps and the paths of shaitan. Now also included in the Quran is the example of the other people of the hellfire who are specifically named. And so we can never say as believers that someone is going to the hellfire, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or any of the messengers clearly and explicitly said that this person is going to the hellfire. So we cannot judge, we cannot say for sure this person is going to the hellfire. We can generally say if somebody does this or this or this, they are going to the hellfire, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deal with each person accordingly. Allah is the judge, we are not the judges. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned some of the people of the hellfire. One of these examples is Abu Lahab and his wife, one of the most evil people at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who tried to harm Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We all know this very short chapter, this very short surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, "Tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tab." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, may the hands of Abu Lahab, this evil man, be ruined, and may he be ruined as well. مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُ مَالُهُ وَمَا كَسَبُ. His wealth will not avail him on the day or that which he's gained. So on the day of judgment, his wealth will not help him. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ. He will enter to burn the hellfire, this man. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues and includes the evil person who helped this man, who helped Abu Lahab, which was his wife. وَامْرَأَتُهُ حَمَّالَةَ الْحَطَابِ. His wife will carry the firewood, meaning she'll be burning in the hellfire with her husband Abu Lahab, carrying the firewood. And the reason for that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, is because his wife, Abu Lahab's wife, used to go to harm the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She used to carry some of the things that will harm him, and she used to put them in his path. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving her the same consequences in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes and says, في جيدها حبل من مسد. Around her neck is a rope made out of twisted fiber, burning her in the hellfire for what she used to do in trying to harm the messenger of the creator sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now one side note on this is that this evil man who is explicitly mentioned, an entire surah is about this man. If you think about it, if this man wanted to, he could have acted, he could have said, I believe in Islam, I believe in Allah. He could have said, I believe in Allah, to try to disprove the Quran. He could have just said that. And then the surah, which is eternal and preserved, the surah would have meant nothing. So if he was not a liar, if he was not a disbeliever, and he had entered Islam, Allah would not have revealed this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals this surah. And this man could have tried, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his knowledge, he knows that this man will never enter Islam. He will never enter because of how evil he is. And so this man is mentioned with an entire surah in the Quran, entire chapter in the Quran, him and his wife as one of the people of the hellfire. And then we also have the example, the explicit and direct example of the wives of two of the prophets of the past. Two of the prophets of the past, their own wives will be in the hellfire. These are prophets Nuh alayhi salam and Lut alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us this example when he says, ضرب الله مثلا للذين كفروا امرأة نوح وامرأة لوط كانتا تحت عبدين من عبادنا صالحين فخانتاهما فلم يغنيا عنهما من الله شيئا وقيل ادخلا النار مع الداخلين. So Allah sets forth an example to the disbelievers. The wife of Prophet Nuh and the wife of Prophet Lut alayhi salam. So they were respectfully under these two righteous people, two righteous slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they were false to their husbands. They tried to deceive their husbands, meaning they did not really believe in Islam. They did not truly believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَقَانَتَاهُمَا فَلَمْ يُغْنِيَا عَنْهُمَا مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا. They profited nothing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on their account, their register, their book of deeds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَقِيلَ ادْخُلَ النَّارُ مَعَ الدَّاقِلِينَ. They will be told, enter the hellfire along with those who enter the hellfire. So this example gives us many lessons. The example of these two prophets and their wives. The main lesson that we can take from this is that these two women are wives of prophets. They're not just any woman. They are wives of actual prophets who came and they were sent with a message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yet their evil was so great, these two women, their evil was so great that they did not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they would be punished for it. The fact that their husbands were prophets was not enough for them to enter paradise and to be protected from the hellfire. Rather, we also have the example that those who are evil, regardless of their families, these people will be tested. So what do we mean by this? Oftentimes the person will ask, what should I do? My family member is losing faith, or my family member is no longer praying. So the response to this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides whom He wills. And those people who are evil and they do not want to be guided, they will go astray. Even if they are family members of prophets, we have the example of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, his own uncle, actually his uncles, his plural uncles. So you look at the example of righteous people and you know this, that if you are insincere and you disbelieve in the signs of the Creator, as a creation, you will suffer regardless of who your family is. You will suffer regardless of your lineage or your family tree or your ethnicity or your culture or language. You will suffer regardless of your fame or power or position or your job or your status amongst the humans. You will suffer regardless of how much wealth you've accumulated. So if you disbelieve and run away from the Creator, you have no one to blame but yourself. And if you look at the opposite of that, you have the example of Fir'aun. His wife was one of the best women that we know of, Asiya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves this woman, and the Prophet told us this woman is amazing. Why? She was the wife of someone evil, Fir'aun. And yet she was so righteous. She was so pious. She was pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is rewarding her with paradise. And that is the example that we have. This concludes our episode for today, inshallah ta'ala. When we continue next time, we will begin discussing some of the deeds of those who are in the hellfire. Some of the things that they did that led them to the hellfire. And we seek refuge in Allah from the torments and the deeds of the inhabitants of the hellfire. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us and to make us of those who are pious. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the highest level of paradise. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Praise be to my Lord.